thanks, Mel, very much for joining us. You might notice I'm a fellow Brit. I'm from the Midlands, and I read that you were from Derbyshire, so I feel like we're practically related.
We are, so it's so small, yeah.
I know, right? So yeah, I'm Jo Richardson. My pronouns are she and her, and I'm an ally to the Pride group at Pega. I hope that you're feeling as well recently like you've got a few thousand few more fans, because I can assure you that when you're having a good day on the golf course, actually our business social media channels light up with photos of you sporting the Pega logo and, you know, everyone kind of getting behind you. There's a lot of rah-rah, and actually you've given us a lot of pride in many senses of the word. So, you know, I hope that you know that we're all behind you, and we think you're one of us now. So that's kind of our starting point. I should let you know as well, before I let Catherine introduce herself, what you're dealing with in terms of golf knowledge. I have tried it once. There were tears, there was frustration, there was weaponizing of the equipment, there was anger, and that was just the person trying to teach me. So I think we got off to a bad start when I just got off to the golf course and I called it a stick. So
it happens. It even happens to me still, so don't feel any shame in that at all. It happens.
Okay, and I'd just like to hand over to Catherine to introduce herself as well.
Thanks, Jo. Yep, my name is Catherine Sullivan. I use she, her pronouns. And just to echo what Jo said, we are so excited to be celebrating Pride with you, to be kicking off our Pride festivities. So just excited that you're joining with us today and sharing in conversation.
Yeah, good.
Great. So I'm going to get started. I had a little look to see, you know, how many golf courses there were in Derbyshire. And I see that there's 37. And having been up there, I'm sure that a lot of them are really, really beautiful. It's a beautiful part of the country. So I kind of thought, well, yeah, you know, if that's where Mel grew up, I can understand her being in a beautiful place there and taking up an interest in golf. But now we look at you and you're kind of really on the global stage and doing incredibly well. So I wanted to start with asking, you know, what was the moment where you thought, this is what I want to do. This is my thing. I want to do this professionally.
Yeah, I still think that sometimes. Well, why I did take up golf as a career. But honestly, like I've always been into sport ever since I've been walking since I was like 7.5 months. And ever since then, I've always been doing something, whether that's skiing, snowboarding. I played football to quite a high level. And yeah, I mean, we were very fortunate. Like the village that I grew up near was a really good golf course. Like my mum and dad were kind of big social people there, more so probably than the golf. But yeah, I mean, I just got into it through that. And a lot of my friends played. I was very fortunate in the golf club that I grew up at Chevin in Derby, that there was a bunch of juniors, a bunch of, you know, many boys that I played with, you know, playing football with, were playing golf. And so that's kind of how I got into it. And people don't understand this about Derby, but we have a lot of options for golf courses. People would never think that. So yeah, we're very fortunate. And I was just fortunate in the people that I kind of, the environment that I was introduced to the game of golf, it was very welcoming, especially towards junior players. And then I just got addicted. I mean, my at Chairman Golf Club, the first 11 holes are uphill, which is a bit scary to a lot of people. And the practice ground is literally at the very top. So my dad would drop me off on a Saturday when he would play with his friends, and I would literally walk 45 minutes up with my golf clubs and my massive practice bag at, you know, 12, 13 years old, and practice all day. And then when he came around the 14th, which is right by the practice area, I'd play the last 5 holes with him and his friends. So it was just all I wanted to do. I knew from probably 13 that I wanted to take it up as a career. I knew that there was opportunity there for me. And yeah, I guess ever since then, I've never really looked back.
No, Mel, I'm hearing you describe your childhood, and I'm thinking back even to when I was a kid growing up in the 90s, and I was just craving any sort of sports coverage of women's sports. And there wasn't a whole lot of content back then, at least I felt like that was true in the U.S. I mean, I remember in 1999 when the U.S. women's soccer team won the World Cup, you know, like the next day we got the paper, and I insisted that we keep it, I keep it. And then when Sports Illustrated arrived, that issue with Brandi Chastain on the front, I get to keep that too, so I could enter it into my like own, you know, personal archive, like a women's sports shrine, right? Because there wasn't a whole lot of content back then. And I'm wondering, you know, the narrative now just feels so different too, because there's more content and I think there's just more demand. I really think people want to see, you know, female athletes on the front page of the sports section. Where do you see that growing demand coming from? Where do you see it going? And where does golf fit into that narrative?
Yeah, I mean, look, I had one of my friends wrote a PhD on women's sports media, and the discovery that she got was kind of shocking. I think it's less than 1% of all media coverage in sport is actually given to women and women's sport, which is completely shocking in my opinion. I certainly think there's been a movement in women's sport over the last few years. I think that now women are saying, hey, you know, we are also very good. We put in just as much dedication. You know, why are you not showcasing us as much as the men? Or, you know, why are you not showcasing us, you know, even a little bit more than what we're getting already? And, you know, that's huge for us. Any kind of exposure we get, I mean, it's not just, it benefits us obviously, but it benefits so much more. It grows the game. Like I've always said that I would love a young girl taking up the game of golf, or a young boy saying, I want to be like Lexi Thompson or Mel Reid or Jess Corder, where it's always, you know, I want to be like Rory or Ricky, because they're just so, they're advertised and they're just, their exposure is just so in your face. I certainly do think it's changing. And I think now as well, what the great thing about it is that, you know, just because you're an athlete and you're a woman doesn't mean that you can't do all the things that women do as well, which is, you know, if you want to have a family, like people have come back and performed amazing, like Katrina Matthew won the British Open for us, you know, 11 weeks, I think, or not, maybe not even 11 weeks after she gave birth to her second child, and won, you know, probably one of our biggest events ever to ever win. And so it just goes to show, like, you know, I hope it grows even more, but I certainly think it's changing over the last 5 or 6 years. I do believe that media coverage, and especially like living in America, I've noticed that a lot, that there is, you know, a lot of women's college games, you know, the NCAA, they are showing women's sport a lot more than they ever do in the UK. So I certainly feel like it is shifting, but I think a lot of it has to do with media coverage, if I'm honest. I think that's where it has to start. Like, we have to get that respect from the media to then be able to like grow, and, you know, even like input of more money into organizations and sports and that organizations, I think still needs to be done, because, you know, the women don't get the same opportunities as the men do.
And how do you feel about the talent of tomorrow that's coming through as well? Because I think actually one of the things that we saw throughout the Olympics when they were in London, the effect of that was all of a sudden kids kind of shifted from, I want to be famous, to I want to be a sports, you know, a sportsman, an athlete, a sportswoman. The other thing that I kind of heard on the news that has happened this year is that actually a lot of kids are wanting to go into the medical profession. They're really, really heavily influenced about what's going on around them at the time. And of course, people have seen a lot of kind of stories about the medical profession in the last year throughout the pandemic. So do you feel like you're under pressure to be a role model as well?
Not really. I think that, you know, I've always had the mentality of, I do want to change the world. I want to change the way that people, because I can only kind of speak for the golfing world, I want to change people's opinion of golf a little bit, that probably are getting into it, that think it's still for, you know, rich, you know, I hate to say it, but rich old guys, country club kind of thing. I do want that to change. And I think that that is what's so cool about something like, you know, I know we spoke about media, but also the Olympics. Like, I just don't understand why, you know, there's some of these guys that, you know, golf is now in the Olympics, why they're not going to play. Like, they're saying, I'm not going to play, it's not great prep for a WGC event, which is the week after, which I do understand. And I understand that growing up, their goal was never to play the Olympics. But for me, now it's in the Olympics. I mean, that is like my absolute goal, because there are so many eyes on the Olympics, so many new eyes that, you know, there's sports in the Olympics I would never normally watch. You know, gymnastics, I would never put on the TV if it had gymnastics on. But during Olympics, love watching the, you know, gymnastics. And I just get really into it. So if I'm like that, then I hope that all these new eyes that, you know, are going to watch golf in the Olympics have a little bit of a different, I guess, perspective and attitude on it, and just want to take up the game because they think it looks cool. And that's, Yeah, I really don't feel any pressure being a role model. I think that it's our responsibility as athletes to grow the game, to invite new people from all kinds of backgrounds, no matter what your background is, for them to want to pick up a golf club and play golf. I think that's a really cool, I think it's a really cool responsibility. And honestly, I think it's a privilege.
And even on a more personal level, how do you mentor maybe some of the younger players on the circuit? How do you reach out to them and sort of show them the way?
Well, it's tough because they're so good now. They're probably mentoring me, but I mean, the young girls and young ladies that are coming out now, and then young guys as well. I mean, they're phenomenal athletes as it is. I think technology has had a huge impact on the game of golf, and everyone's just really, really good. But if I ever do, have somebody come up to me and ask me for a piece of advice, the best piece of advice, honestly, I can give is don't try and be like anybody else. You know, it's very easy to get on tour. And again, I can only kind of speak from a golf perspective, but to get on tour and say, oh, what's she doing? Absolutely try and learn little bits from people. But at the end of the day, like, you've got here for a reason. Just keep doing you and, learn a little bit, on the way. But at the end of the day, don't try and be somebody else. That's kind of my advice that I give to the young rookies coming out. And, if they ever do ask for my advice, that's the advice that I give them.
I think that's great advice. I mean, did you have someone that was that person for you as you sort of moved through your career as well?
I've been really, really fortunate. I had, I grew up watching Laura Davies play golf. I now consider her a really good friend. She's been great throughout my whole career, and Laura does it Laura's way. I think that's why she's had longevity, honestly. I think that she's still an incredible player. I think that she is honestly just true to herself and the way she does things. She doesn't alter that. Like, she's always said, I'm not a practicer. I love playing, not a practicer. That's very hard for a lot of golfers to do. We're kind of over practicers and we get so tied up in the technique. And I've also had Kari Webb, again, someone I looked up to and I've been very fortunate to become very good friends with. And, I think she's had a huge impact. Like, she's put in a lot of time with me, especially when I lived down in Jupiter. I was only 20 minutes from her and I would, pester all the time, basically, to play golf with me. And again, a phenomenal role model for the women's game. She's done so much for Australian golf. And just the advice that I get from her, because, again, she did things her way and she made a few mistakes. But that's basically what them two have both said to me. And I think those two are, some of the best role models we have in our game.
So, Mel, you've alluded to the fact that historically, golf has been viewed as a bit of a, sort of bit of a boys club. It's for men of a certain maybe financial standing as well. And that probably includes a lot of the people that work in the golf industry, as well as the golfers themselves. Do you think that that's impacted the way that women golfers feel on the courses and in the facilities as well?
100%. Like, a great example, I'm not going to name the club, but I live up in Jacksonville now. It's a pretty well-known golf club. My fiance just took up a golf lesson on Sunday, which is probably the worst thing I could have done, because now she wants to play golf all the time. So we played golf late last night and went to this place. I've been told it was really, really cool. It's only 12 holes. I've heard that the owner's incredible, like, very casual. I was like, perfect. Went in the shop and I was like, hey, I'm not like asking for any discount or anything, but like, do you do any like LPGA rates? And he's like, oh, we only do PGA Tour rates. And I was like, okay, well, any chance like my club's shut on a Monday, can I just come use the putting green? And he's like, no, that's only PGA Tour guys can do that. And like, so that's not been the first time in the last couple of years that I've had golf clubs just be not very welcoming. Like, there's no budge in the pool. And the reason that I kind of say this story is because if I feel a little bit uncomfortable at golf courses and, I'm an LPGA player and I've been on tour for a lot of years, how can I like try and promote the game when, if that's happening to me, God knows what is happening to, women trying to get in the game, people from minorities coming into the game, how they must feel. Because I hate it, because I just want every golf club to make people feel comfortable. And I've been very fortunate, like, I'm Atlantic Beach Golf Club up here, and they're one of the most incredible golf clubs I've ever been part of. They're so welcoming, very, very casual. It's very modern day golf, which does them a huge favor. Like, they have people wanting to become members there all the time. And I think that that just goes to show what a great club it is. And I had some great golf courses in Florida, I had great golf courses in Derby that were like that, but there's still a lot of clubs that make me feel uncomfortable. And that's something that I probably shouldn't be as vocal as I am, but if it's, I want it to change. So I'm not scared of being vocal about it at the same time.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. I mean, maybe to talk about technology as it relates to this question too, and you're going to have to educate me and Joe probably on this one, but as it relates to course design or even club technology or gear technology, where can the industry, the golf industry, reinvest in the women's game in a way that makes it, you know, meaningful and makes a meaningful impact on the sport as a whole?
That is a good question. I don't know. Honestly, I think social media is huge as an advertisement and promotion basis. I think that, you know, if they did do separate women group sessions, that would be great, not only for women to feel a bit more comfortable. I think it'd be great for women to meet women in the same kind of space as them. I just think it's a very safe environment. And I think it's a great way to introduce women that, you know, let's be honest, are a little bit scared about going to golf clubs, you know, without their husbands or without their significant other. And so I think something like that, like promoting, you know, really fun, you know, brunch golf day, golf hours or whatever it is, that is at least, you know, attractive to women who are just getting into the game. I think something like that would be really good.
And even more broadly, stepping back beyond gender, how can golf be more inclusive and equitable to all?
Again, another really great question. I think it comes honestly from a lot of things. I think honestly, like, golf club staff is huge. I think that if you arrive at a golf club, you should feel welcome to be there. And I think that that starts from the first person you meet at the golf club. I think that, you know, management teams should prep their staff maybe a little bit better and be like, listen, we are a welcoming golf club to all. Like, that is how you treat somebody, is as soon as they get into the gates, they are welcome here, and you do all you can to make them feel welcome and make them want to come back, and not only come back, but invite their friends to come back. You know, that just helps everybody. And I think honestly, that's where it actually stems from, is a lot of it from educating the staff.
No, I think that's a great point. I want to shift slightly to talk about sort of what it means to be Mel Reid and what it means to have the competitive mindset that you have. And I'm thinking specifically, you know, if people don't play golf, they probably don't realize that it is an incredibly demanding sport, both physically and mentally. And so I'm wondering what your journey has been throughout your career to get your game to that level, you know, whether it's physically, mentally, or even strategically, right, over the course of a weekend or a tournament weekend, like trying to map out those days. What has that journey been like for you?
It's tough. Like, people just see you at the end of, you know, I mean, I've won once on the LPGA. That was literally 20 years of hard work to even get close to that moment. You know, I've had other great moments in Europe, but LPGA I do feel is a little bit of a different platform, a little bit of a different stage. Honestly, people just see you with the trophy and think, wow, she's so talented. Like, they don't understand the hours and the grind. And, you know, I've had flights to go to tournaments at 12 p.m. on a Sunday afternoon, and I've got up at 5 to train and just grind a little bit, something that I wasn't quite comfortable with. And people just don't, you know, in the rain, and people just don't see the amount of hard work that you have to put in, especially in something like golf, where it is so technical, and it's something so small off can be really big off. And it's a mental grind. Like, I think that, you know, when you're playing well, you feel like you can't miss a shot. And then when you're struggling, you're trying to find something all the time, you're trying to find something, and sometimes you overdo things, sometimes you don't do things enough. Like, it's a constant balance. Like, sometimes you have to work harder, sometimes not as much. Like, you just got to tweak a few things. Like, it's honestly a constant, like, not just a mental battle during tournaments, but it's actually a mental battle in practice as well, and training, and, you know, should I be working on this and should I be doing this? Like, that's why you've got to have such a great team. And that's something that I am so proud of, is like my team that I've created around me. And it's took me a lot of years to, you know, create that team. But it's literally the first time in my career that over the last probably 1.5 years, I'm really happy and stable with my team. And that also makes a huge impact of the environment that you surround yourself with. So yeah, people don't, you know, people don't understand what you do in the dark, you know, just so you can shine the light. Like, it is so true. And yeah, it's hard. It's really, really hard. But at the same time, like, I love it. I love the grind. I love trying to figure things out. And, you know, it wears me down sometimes. But also, I've never felt, you know, the energy of when I hit a good shot. Like, I don't get that from anything else.
So, Mel, we will come back and touch on some questions that talk to you a little bit about your team, because we're quite interested in digging into that a little bit in a few minutes' time. But first of all, just to kind of, you know, carry on this theme as well, can you tell us about a time where, you know, maybe you fell short of a goal, and what inspired you to keep going on, and, you know, that kind of mental strength, the grit to dig in? What are your inspirations to just keep pounding away at this?
I think there's been a few over the course of my career. I mean, I've certainly had very high highs, but I've had more lows, if I'm completely honest. Well, probably not more lows, but I've certainly had lows. And, you know, especially, you know, when I think probably my lowest low was, you know, when my mum passed away, I probably came back to the game a little bit too quickly, had really bad 2 or 3 years, completely lost myself, like just needed to just be kind of do my own thing. And you can't really do that in golf. Like you can't really just, I was trying to obviously grieve, but like I couldn't deal with anything, like, because it was so public and so, like, you know, people to see a golf score, like a score that you've shot, and, you know, they just think that you've not played well, and there's so many other things going on. And, you know, my best friend who I grew up playing golf with since I was 11 years old, Brianne, still my best friend, you know, she brought me out of that, you know. So, and then there's been other times where, you know, I got on the LPGA, lost my card, you know, another one of my friends brought me out of that, you know, who actually told me to kind of publicly come out. And that was like kind of a big thing for me, because it actually gave me a lot of inspiration to inspire people, you know, to kind of showcase that this is who I am, you know, and you should be who you are. And it actually, yeah, I mean, honestly, it kind of rebirthed my kind of third part of my career, I guess. I think that, so I'm very lucky that I've had people very close to me that have inspired me. And yeah, honestly, like we spoke about before, like just growing the game, like I want people to take up the game of golf, because they were like, I watched you play and I thought it was really cool. I thought, you know, how you played was cool. And, you know, I just really liked your aura. And, you know, that to me is kind of the, once I finished my career, is people to be like, you're the reason I took up golf. That to me is kind of the icing on the cake of a career, is that's really cool that I inspired you. And that's honestly my driving force most of the time, is inspiring not just the younger generation, honestly, anybody, to just try and pick up and play this amazing game that, you know, I've dedicated a lot of my life to and will always be part of my life.
That's great. It's really nice to hear. It really comes through, your passion. And also it's really nice to hear that actually the inspiration very often comes down to people. And I think, you know, we've all missed the connectivity with people at the moment in the last year or so. So I think that will really, really kind of resonate with a lot of listeners.
Yeah, you know, we're
good. Sorry. I hope so, because, you know, when people say, like, who is your ultimate four ball, which is the laziest question on the planet, but I always say, like, honestly, it's my four, like my three best mates, you know, in a golf cart playing golf with, you know, some beers or whatever we have available to drink. And because I'm like, these people have saved me, you know, they literally are like blood to me. So, yeah, I mean, you know, you get inspiration from all kinds of things. I've gotten it from, very fortunately, from the people closest to me, which I'm extremely grateful and appreciative of.
That is, yeah. The idea of like your three best friends and some beers on a golf course sounds pretty nice, I'll say. I will say, you know, we're talking about golf, and no shock to you, but Joe and I are not professional athletes by any means. But I think what you're saying really does translate really to those who are listening in. And so, for someone who, you know, might not be a pro athlete, but, you know, might be behind a computer and looking to perfect their craft, what advice would you give to that person, again, who's really just trying to be a master of their craft?
Just put your best foot forward. I think that, you know, sometimes I don't have it. Sometimes, you know, like this morning, I grinded for 4 hours and felt like I didn't really get much better. I got a little bit better, but like I was like, wow, I've just grinded for 4 hours and it doesn't look much better, but it feels a little whatever. And I'm like, you know, sometimes you just gotta understand that sometimes you're just doing your best. I think that that's all you can do. You know, people, especially with like social media, and you know, everyone has this fake life that everyone puts on. They don't put on the bad stuff. And at the end of the day, I just think you've just got to say, hey, sometimes my best self is me you know, not making the bed in the morning and having a coffee and sitting on the sofa and, you know, feeling a little bit sorry for myself. Sometimes that is the best you have to give that day. And I think that that's fine. I think that people get so wound up that they should always be moving this way, when actually, if you just put your best foot forward at any given point, you are doing it this way, just not in a, you know, in a more of a process way, not in an outcome way. And eventually those days will all add up and they will, something good will come of it. Like, I truly believe that. That's something that, you know, I live by most days. And I think that way it just keeps you a lot more level headed as well. I think that you're like, that was the absolute best I could have done today. And I'm really proud of that. And people might not think it was good, but I thought that was the absolute best I could have done today.
I think having patience with yourself, especially, right? I mean, I think especially during the pandemic, yeah, I think for everybody, it's like, learn to be patient with yourself, cut yourself a break.
Especially, yeah, I mean, just be kind to yourself. You know, I think, like I said, we just live in this world now where everything has to be amazing. And, you know, there's different kinds of amazing, in my opinion. And yeah, you just have to give yourself a break sometimes and just be like, I'm doing my best. You know, I'm going to be kind to myself. I'm a good person. Good things are going to happen to me. And that's the way that you have to, for me, that's the way I live my life is, you know, life is good. You know, it may not seem it to other people, or sometimes obviously people go through stuff, and I 100% sympathize with that. I've been through stuff, but you know, you just got to keep putting your best foot forward, and eventually you'll come out of the dip, and then sometimes you'll just accelerate. So that's just something that I live by, is just always having, you know, your own back, honestly, is just patting yourself on the back most times and saying, wow, I'm doing a really good job.
Mel, we are so excited to be celebrating Pride with you. Pride means a little bit of something different to everybody, and it gets celebrated in different ways around the world, and it gets celebrated at different times, actually, in different parts of the world. What does Pride mean to you?
I think ultimately Pride just means, the first word that comes into my head is inclusion. You know, it's something that I'm very proud to be part of their community, and I'm also extremely proud, obviously, with the work that Pega are doing with it as well, and it's pretty cool to be part of. And yeah, I mean, I'm a true believer that we're all human beings at the end of the day, and it doesn't matter what your background, your religion, who you love, we're all human beings. And I just think that Pride Month is just a fantastic month to celebrate inclusion. Honestly, I think that's all it comes down to.
Yeah, I really like that. I mean, I also feel like I've been spending more time reflecting, you know, leading up and into Pride too. I was thinking the other day about how it's been 10 years since I've come out, which on one hand feels like so long ago. I mean, I was a totally different person in my early 20s. But on the other hand, it feels like it was just yesterday. And I think part of that reason too is that when you're part of the LGBTQ community, in some ways, to bring your authentic self forward, you have to kind of continuously come out in new situations. So, you know, when I started at Pega, that was, right, how can I bring my authentic self forward to my team, to my boss, right? But it's even like if you're going to a barbecue and you're meeting friends of friends, how do you bring your authentic self even to that barbecue? So I'm wondering, as a female athlete, as a member of the LGBTQ community, how do you bring your authentic self to the sport?
I just talk about my partner, honestly. Like, I think that, you know, I get asked a lot of times as well, like, oh, what did your husband do? And I'm like, well, my husband's a girl, her name's Carly. And, you know, it is, it's like, you know, there's so many situations where you have to like come out again. And I think that it's kind of, you know, I don't get uncomfortable about it anymore, but that's taken a long time, if I'm completely honest. And I totally get why people are scared to be their true authentic self, because it is a lot, you know, it's just something that a lot of people don't have to deal with. It's kind of people just in the community that have to constantly tell their story, I guess. And, you know, it's really hard to do it the first time. It doesn't get much easier the second or the third or the fourth. And, you know, until you're 100% comfortable with yourself. And I think that one of the kind of rules that I have, and, you know, when I met Carly, you know, I was the first, you know, the first girl she'd been with. And so, you know, one of the things that I told her was, the more you're comfortable with it, the more just automatically that energy, they become more comfortable with it in the conversation. And I think that that's something that I just learned over, honestly, over trial and error. I was like, you know what, when people ask me who my partner is, just be completely honest, because there was times, you know, in past relationships or before I wasn't quite comfortable, I would not necessarily make up a story, but I would just hide away that side of my life. And I was like, what am I doing? Like, you know, so yeah, that's honestly one of the biggest pieces of advice I could give, is the more comfortable you are with it, just naturally more comfortable people in the conversation just get with it.
And when you decided to make that part of your sort of public-facing persona, did you have apprehensions about really telling that truth?
Of course. I didn't within my own circle. Everybody that I actually really cared about their opinion knew, that'd known for a while. That wasn't really what I was scared of. I was a little bit scared of what my, you know, my fellow competitors that I'm obviously, we kind of become a family on tour. Like I was a bit worried about them. But honestly, the response, 99.9% of it was extremely positive. I mean, who doesn't want them, their friends or somebody that they know to be authentically themselves? I mean, I think that if you don't want that, then you've got an issue not with that, you've got an issue with yourself. So, yeah, and I, honestly, like, I just felt it was the right time for me. I felt very comfortable in my own skin. Like I said, I wanted to change the world just a little bit to make it a little bit better. And I just felt like me having a very small platform, but I had somewhat of a platform. I just thought it was an important, I thought it was an important message to give out, because there will be a young girl or young boy, or a young, you know, member of the LGBTQ community who doesn't have that voice and doesn't have a, not necessarily that I'm a role model, but like doesn't have a role model that is brave enough to be themselves. And, you know, that might have just changed their opinion a little bit and made them brave to be who they are. And that's basically why I did it. I just wanted to help people. And, you know, the messages and stuff that I got was, you know, from literally the widest range. You know, I had a guy the next day at the golf club, and, you know, I was a little bit nervous about going to the golf club the next day because, you know, middle of the day, it's only kind of me and pros that are practicing. And then there's a bunch of, you know, the older generation there. And this guy came up to me, he must've been 80. And he's like, I've just read your story. And I was like, oh, here we go. I was like, okay. He's like, no, I want to tell you, like, I struggled with my granddaughter being gay and I read your story and I must apologize to her because you just made me see it in a completely different light. And I was like, that's exactly what I'm trying to get. And, you know, fair play to him. And I'm proud of the way he then reacted. And that's why I did it, is to just be, try and educate people and, you know, be the brave kind of face for a lot of people that are struggling with that, because it's a real thing.
We need more Mels in the world, especially public figures.
People might say no, but only one's enough, I think.
So listen, Mel, I'm just thinking of us at Pega. So we have what are called in the corporate world as employee resource groups. So that for us, Pride at Pega, is a group that is set up, and it is for, it's for the community. It's actually, we kind of refer to it as being in the family. And also there's a number of other people in it who are like me, they're allies. And one of the things that we really struggled with is that the employee resource group was set up, and I thought, well, this is the group for me to go and be an ally with. I have a lot of friends in my personal life who are within this community. I love them. I love this community. I want to be here. So, you know, a number of us kind of ran into it and we were like, great, yippee, now what? What do I do as an ally? And it's been something that we've kind of struggled with a little bit, not just in Pride at Pega, but in a lot of the groups that we have, is that we are desperate to support anyone who feels marginalised, but we don't quite know how, what that looks like, how we should do it. And it looks different within every group, because each different group has different challenges to deal with. So I'm interested from your point of view, because I'm very interested in the allyship part of it. Have you been in a situation where someone really showed up for you? Or have you been in a situation where someone didn't show up for you and you wished that they had had your back a bit more? And what would that have looked like for you?
First of all, I just want to say thank you. And second of all, you just being you and being like, so, I guess comfortable, and like, that's doing enough. You know, I feel like people feel they should be, you know, putting rainbow flags everywhere. And I'm like, no, you just accepting it and you having no issue with it at all is enough. And I think that there's, you know, I think the one kind of, the luckiest thing in the world for me was that my family were, I mean, I think my dad knew since I could walk, you know. I think that, you know, it wasn't really a massive shock to them. Even though I dated, a, you know, too many guys when I was younger. But it was, they would, their support was everything to me. And my sister, like, even now, like, she's over the top supportive, you know, she's amazing. But, yeah, I mean, there's certainly been situations, you know, people within my team who, you know, I regard my team as family. And, you know, back when I wasn't out, you know, there were situations where I got advised not to be out. And at the time, it didn't really have an effect on me. But over the a couple years or two or three years, I was like, why am I getting sponsorship from this company who actually would, it's illegal to be gay in their country. Like, why am I proudly representing them on my hat or on my sleeve? And I think that that's where, you know, nowadays, like, I only have brands that represent what I'm about, which is why, you know, again, Pega, great fit. Like, what you guys are doing, an unbelievable fit. And it's something that I'm proud to wear now. So yeah, I mean, obviously there has been situations where I've been told not to be myself, and it's had a huge effect on me, not in the, at that particular time, but down the road, it definitely had a huge effect on me.
I was going to say to you as well, you know, do you have any advice for allies who are looking to support their peers? And I think that actually you've kind of wrapped it up in a nutshell, really, which is just be cool, just accept people for who they are. You know, it's all good. Is there anything else? You know, is there anything that you think that people can do that is, it doesn't even have to be big and public and showy, but it just lets someone know that you are there?
Honestly, just for me, that's a really good question. You guys are giving really good questions. You're making my brain spinning right now. Honestly, just being 100% comfortable with it is probably, that's what we all want, right? Like, we all want to, you know, as human beings, we want to be part of something. And if everyone is on the same page, that to me is what a community is all about. And so, yeah, you know, you might have a friend who is struggling with their son or daughter, you know, being gay or being part of the community, and you just giving them advice and almost educating them a little bit, like, listen, really, is that, like, this is fine, like, this is what is going to happen, like, you need to be there, like, just be like that supporting friend or relative or whoever it might be, just so, like, that to me is the biggest gift, is when, you know, somebody like yourself says, what can I do for the community? It's honestly just being comfortable, and that's the best way that you can support the community. Honestly, that's my take on it. It doesn't need to be loud and, you know, public or anything like that. It's just being 100% comfortable with it.
And even beyond that, at the organizational level, I'm curious, how can an organization that you might partner with be inclusive of its LGBTQ community?
I think, like, for example, me telling my story, you know, I did that through Athlete Ally, which tells stories of LGBTQ plus athletes. I think that's huge. I think that their platform they have, they do it in a very tasteful, you know, very, very, I can't even think of the word, very subtle way. I think having that, you know, me growing up, I would have loved a role model, you know, because I kind of knew, I think we all know at some point, but I knew pretty early on that, you know, I was probably gay, and I would have loved to have a role model who was somebody who I could look up to, somebody who I was like, wow, that's really cool that they're that comfortable with it and that they're just being the best version of themselves. Like, that would have been really cool for me. So I think that, like, platforms like that and organizations like that are huge, especially in sport where it is a little bit more of a taboo, I think, especially in men's sport. Like, I feel like we do have it slightly easier as women, like, people are a little bit more accepting of it. But, you know, for the guys, I think it's even harder, you know, the locker room chat, and, you know, you've got to be alpha to be, you know, a male athlete. And I think that, you know, having more stories of male athletes and high profile athletes as well is really going to be the game changer.
Yeah. As folks like yourself continue to tell your story, what do you think that means to that next generation of kids turning, like, on the TV? You know, maybe trying to have that conversation with their parents, with their friends. What do you think that means for those kids?
Hopefully it makes them feel safe. Honestly, hopefully, you know, they go, well, if Mel can do it, I can do it. You know, that's something that I take great pride in, is that I do hope I am role models for the younger generation of the community. Somebody that they do look up to is someone who was brave and somebody who honestly is very comfortable with it, you know, more than comfortable with it. It's just who I am. It's the way I've been born. And, you know, I'm extremely happy and we're going to have all the nice things that we're supposed to have in life. And, you know, if we want a family, we can do that. If we want to get married, we can do that. And, you know, it doesn't stop you from doing anything. Like, that's the thing. Like, so hopefully it just educates people, you know, that it's not as scary thing as it once was. It's a completely normal thing in my eyes. And again, it all goes back to being human beings, right? Like, we just, the more happier human beings are, the better the world will be. And hopefully these young kids and people that are uncomfortable with it can look at people who are open and have told their story and be like, that's really cool. And I want to be, you know, I want to be that person. It hasn't altered any sponsorship. It hasn't, if anything, it's actually, I've actually gained a lot more. Like, I've gained a lot more respect. I've gained, you know, partnerships I actually want to partner with. You know, I've gained an unbelievable partner. Like, so there's so many more positives from it than I ever could have ever wished for. So it's made my life better telling my story.
Can I just ask a question, Mel, that, you know, it's great to hear that actually you've done something that initially looked really scary and it's worked out brilliant and you have gained from it. How did you feel when, you know, you literally had just unleashed the genie from the bottle? Was it, I'm relieved now because I don't have to kind of worry about whether I'm trying to conceal this about myself, you know, were you worried? You know, did you think, oh my goodness, what have I done?
Yeah, honestly, like I literally sat there and I knew the story had come out and I wouldn't look at my phone because almost like my protective shield had gone. And so I was extremely vulnerable. You know, I was vulnerable to comments and I was just, you know, people's opinions, which, you know, we say we don't care, but obviously we do for human beings. And, you know, I was also worried about people that I hadn't told, like, even though they knew, like, I hadn't personally told them. And so, yeah, I felt extremely vulnerable. But then, you know, you see some of the reactions and you see some of the positivity and you get the messages from people saying, wow, this is amazing. Like, I'm also gay and I'm scared to come out. Now you've given me the strength to come out. Like, that then, like, kind of rebuilds you up and it makes you an even bigger shield, like when that all kind of settles down. And yeah, it is, but it's scary. I mean, I think it's scary for anybody. And like I said, I've had a very easy run at it, honestly, but you know, it's been difficult. You know, my partner, she won't mind this bringing it up. Like, she's Catholic, you know, Midwest Catholic. And, you know, she was extremely scared, you know, and we had to work through that together. And, you know, I 100% on her time, but I was just her support system. And you know, that worked out a lot better than she thought, but there's a lot of situations where it doesn't, a lot more than I can even imagine, you know, and I've seen that for my close friends at home as well. Like, I've seen them be kicked out of the house. I see them not speak to their parents. And it just makes me extremely sad because I just want to almost just educate the, you know, the parents or the people involved and just, well, it's not that scary. Like, what you envision is not that scary. Like, oh no, I'm not going to have grandkids. I'm like, of course you can have grandkids. Like, if that's what they want, but maybe they don't want that. Like, it's their life, you know, they have to live their own life. Like, that's surely what, you know, I read a quote the other day, like one of my favorite artists, Banksy, and he said, you know, parents will do anything for their children except let them be themselves. And I just thought that was such a cool message. And it's kind of extremely true in a lot of situations. And like I said, I've been very fortunate, but I know more people than I'd like to admit that have had a really, really difficult time with it and still have a difficult time with it.
Yeah, I think you need to be sort of patient with people, as you say, and sort of let them come along on the journey with you. I mean, I feel fortunate in many ways too. You know, my family has been super supportive, but you know, to the point where now my sisters have better pride swag than I do. But you know, that wasn't always the case, and so now I need to shop in their closets. There's no pun there. But I think, you know, your greatest gift, you know, in not having maybe that role model when you were thinking about this, now you can be that role model to others. And it's your way of giving back, right? It is your way of showing people that it does get better. And so the more folks like yourself, whether public facing, I mean, whether professional athletes or even people who, you know, work at Pega can come forward and say, you know, it does get better. I think that's a really encouraging and also just powerful thing to be able to do, to be able to give back to the world. So, I mean, thank you for doing that, for making that, you know, decision to make that part of your public narrative. Obviously it's always been part of you. But you know, just beyond Peg, I know I'm sure you are changing lives in your story. So thank you.
No, I appreciate it. I think you made a good point there as well. Like, you know, it took me until I was, what, 28 to publicly come out. And so sometimes when people say, like, my parents didn't react well, or my relatives or my friends, and I'm like, it took me 28 years to tell my story. Like, give them some time. Like, time is, I truly believe, one of the best healers. And, you know, just be patient. Like, you know, educate them, be support, you know, supportive about the way they're feeling as well. And or you can always come to a middle ground. I truly believe that, like, if communication is key in a lot of ways, and every single relationship that you're ever part of, whether that's a work relationship, you know, your partner, your family, any relationship, communication to me is huge. And I just really believe that time is a big, big healer. And just sometimes people just need a little bit more time to just digest a few things. And but I'm always extremely confident that there will always be a middle ground.
So, Mel, I wanted to ask, you know, when you got to that point, did you feel that you had seen this handled well by anyone else who was in maybe the sports world or a public figure, or, you know, in this, a similar situation to this? Did you have role models that you thought, actually, you know what, that they have done this, and actually I think that they did this very gracefully. This is, you know, this is encouraging me. This is how I want to do it.
Yeah, I mean, there's certainly the ones that come at the top of my head is obviously Sue Bird and Ashton Harris. I think, you know, Megan Rapinoe, you know, they're the ones that are kind of popping into my head that I just believe are the ultimate role models, honestly, in every single way. They're extremely strong women. They're extremely powerful women. And, you know, they use their platform kind of the same way that, well, on a much bigger scale, the same way that I'm doing. So, yeah, I mean, they're certainly people that, or the women that I look up to. And I think what they're doing, I think they're completely badasses, honestly. And I respect everything that they're doing. And, you know, we need more people like that. Because sometimes in our community, you do feel like you're the only one. You know, if you're from Midtown, you know, Midwest, a small town, you know, you are the only one sometimes. And it's just nice to not feel that. And I think that's the beauty nowadays of, you know, the pros and cons, obviously, of social media. But, you know, it's made this very, very big world very, very small. So, yeah, I mean, I think what they're doing is a great thing. And I'm just trying to kind of follow their footsteps, I guess. I guess they do inspire me. And, you know, before I came out, one of my friends did send me a few things that they'd done. And I was like, that's really cool. Like, that's something that I definitely want to do. So, yeah, I've definitely got inspiration from other athletes that have told their story and had, you know, a lot of great success from it.
So I've been Instagram stalking you, or what normal people call following you on Instagram, for a while. And I saw at Christmas that you got engaged to Carly, which is great news. So congratulations.
Most awkward engagement on the planet, by the way. I never get awkward or embarrassed. Worst moment of my life. Bye.
Why?
I just stood there and she even had to say, you're going to ask me. So I just punched back, like, it's like, what do we do now? So, yeah, no. Yeah. So, yeah, she's still got a little bit of time to get out from it. But, yeah.
She's not going to.
Yeah, I know. I hope not.
So tell me, how are you and Carly going to be celebrating Pride this year? Because we're all kind of, we're trying to figure out ways that we can do it in Pega. So trying to feel together but apart. And, you know, with all of our different restrictions globally going on, what will you and Carly be doing to celebrate Pride this year?
Well, her birthday's in June, so we don't
even
need any, yeah, we don't need any more excuses to celebrate. But, you know, obviously my schedule is extremely busy in June. I try and go to a Pride every single year whenever I can. Obviously last year, a lot of things got taken away. But yeah, I mean, we've got some cool ideas that we're going to do, like a couple cool posts. And obviously with Pega, the new hat, which I'm very excited to rock in June. And I know so many girls are going to be jealous about that. So I love making the other girls envious about that. So, yeah, I mean, we'll obviously, unfortunately, we're probably just going to post a lot about us, which I'm sure people are sick of by now. But, you know, I mean, her story is pretty cool as well. I mean, her story is worth sharing as well. So, yeah, we'll see. Like I said, it's probably my busiest month, which is a bit of a shame. But, yeah, we'll rock some rainbow somewhere, I'm sure.
Brilliant. We look forward to watching it on Instagram. So Mel, thank you so much for talking to us today. It's been an absolute joy. You know, we talk about bringing your authentic self, and you've really done that. And you've been very candid and open and honest with us. I've learned an enormous amount just from listening to you, and, you know, lessons that I'm going to take forward in how I go on to be an ally in the world. So we really do appreciate that.